He's going to lead SportsCenter in a backflip amidst the flashing lights. Diving stop, Tatis! Jono to deep left field, and it is a grand slam to walk it off! The second bases clearing double, Eric Hosmer, have a night!
What a shot by Will Myers!
Here's the 2-2, swing and a miss.
The San Diego Padres are getting a top flight starter.
Yu Darvish
in a high-octane heater.
Former Cy Young Award winner Blake Snell.
Blake Snell has great feel for every pitch.
Joe Musgrove.
Hassan Kim are going to help the Padres.
And the Padres are off the charts.
The Padres ball club we all know and love today started out in 1936 as a minor league team in the Pacific Coast League. They played at Lane Field in Broadway downtown until they moved to Westgate Park in 1958. An editor for the Union Tribune, Jack Murphy, led a push for a new stadium in Mission Valley for the San Diego Chargers that began construction in 1965 and opened August 20th, 1967. In 1981, it would be named Jack Murphy Stadium, and in 1997, it would be named Qualcomm. 1 year later, the Padres were brought into Major League Baseball as one of four new expansion teams along the Montreal Expos, Washington Nationals, Kansas City Royals, and the Seattle Pilots. In 1984, the Padres made the playoffs for the first time in franchise history. They finished the season 92-70, winning the NL West. They would go on to play the daunting Cubs in the National League Championship and take the series in dramatic fashion in 5 games. The Padres went to the World Series to play the Detroit Tigers, and unfortunately lost in 5 games, winning one.
The heartbreaking loss for the Padres worsens as they have to return for spring training in Yuma, Arizona.
We just mix in an occasional mint julep, and we have cookies and milk before Betty Bye.
And that's on an exciting night at the Padres spring training camp in Yuma, Arizona. To the players, Yuma is strictly a four-letter word. Those I spoke with who have been with other teams and other training sites in both Florida and Arizona consider Yuma, Arizona, no offense, the absolute pits. Padres are probably wise to choose a spring training site that isn't, exactly Las Vegas in terms of its distractions. I mean, the exhibition games for the players become the highlight of the 6 weeks. The rest of the time is pretty much fundamentals and then the nightlife.
Following the 1984 season, the Padres went on to make the playoffs only one more time in 1996, where they got swept by the St. Louis Cardinals in the first round of the playoffs.
First, Joey Hamilton in trouble right off the bat with two men on Gary Gaetti. Hits one deep to right center, and that one is gone. Sixth homer versus the Padres this year. Hamilton says, am I bleeding? I just got tagged 3-0 St. Louis.
Things began to shift going into the 1998 season. The historic season for the Padres was led by a fabulous pitching rotation with Andy Ashby and Kevin Brown, as well as one of the best closers of all time in Trevor Hoffman. Hoffman has over 600 career saves, and in the 1998 season alone had 53 saves. On top of all these Padre greats, the man that led the charge was Mr. Padre Tony Gwynn. We were able to sit down with lifelong Padre superfan and over 3-decade-long Padre season ticket holder, Susie Butcher. We got to see how special the 98 season was.
The most important one, I think, was 1998. When we went to the World Series. You know, that was just from beginning to end, that was so exciting. Because we went in 1984 for our first World Series, but 98, the stadium had more seats. It got rebuilt a little bit at Jack Murphy, and there was more seats. There was like 70,000 people there. It was, people were yelling and screaming, and they were playing music, and it was just, I don't know, even as well as we are now, I can't imagine anything being better than 1998. It was amazing.
Duro, lo que me gusta es que tú te dejas llevar. Duro, todo lo que tienes ella sale a vacilar. Duro, mi gata no para.
After winning the division while finishing the year with the franchise's best record of all time, 98-64, the Padres sought out to become world champions. They faced the Houston Astros in the NL divisional round, winning the series 3-1. Following that, they faced the Atlanta Braves and overcame a late push by the Braves to win the pennant and marked their stakes in the ground to face the stacked New York Yankees. Despite Padre legend Tony Gwynn batting .500 in the series, the Padres were overmatched by the unbelievable offense and defense by the Yankees as they got swept in the best of five series.
Fittingly with a throw, and the Yankees have done it again. Number 24. They are the world champions of baseball in 1998.
Although Padre legends like Tony Gwynn and Trevor Hoffman never ended up winning a World Series, their achievements as players and their impacts on the San Diego community live on forever.
And I remember one special event when I was in the Navy. I was stationed at the Balboa Naval Hospital, and our luncheons were always on Saturdays. Well, for some reason, we had to have a luncheon on a Wednesday, and Tony was going to be there. And I thought, you know, I got to get time off from work to be there. I just got to get some time off from work for a lunch. So they gave me a lunch hour, a long lunch hour. So I go to there. I'm a Navy chief. So I go to the lunch, and I'm in my chief's uniform and everything because I couldn't change. So Tony was our guest, and he came up to me afterwards, thanked me for my service. I got my picture taken with him. He signed a ball for me. And he's just always been great with everybody. And now to watch his son doing some of the broadcasts, it's just, he sounds just like Tony, you know? And I'd love to see him come up, but we all love Tony.
After the 1998 season, the Padres only made the playoffs two times in the next 8 years, making the playoffs in both 2005 and 2006, losing both times to the St. Louis Cardinals. The Padres were an embarrassment, and they were tough to watch. Losing season after losing season, and up to 2004, there was no hope. In 2004, the Padres were able to find a new home in downtown San Diego. Petco Park holds more than 42,000 people, and truly brings to life that San Diegan relaxed feel. The first ever game at the park set the tone for years to come.
Sit! Get down! Get down! And now the Padres win! Hello, Petco! How you doing?
The future seemed bright for the Padres with the hot start in their home opener. However, it was just the beginning for a long drought of below 500 baseball.
Throughout the ages, the Padres have had their fair share of managers, many of which getting fired due to the team's long periods of losing. Some recent managers include former Padre Bruce Bochy, Bud Black, Andy Green, and current manager Jace Tingler. After the underwhelming era of the early 2000s, Padres ownership showed some initiative in signing big names in hopes of making a World Series run in the near future. In 2018, the Padres signed former World Series champion Eric Hosmer to an 8-year deal. The next year, the Padres were able to sign 4-time All-Star and 2-time Gold Glove winner Manny Machado to a 10-year, $300 million contract.
Por amigos que no son amigos en verdad. Porque sé que te van a escribir cuando él se va.
Everybody go to the disco.
Y ahora a lo puro y sin disimulo, olvidando la pena, la piel. Ahora hace lo que quiere, cuando quiere y si no quiere, eres otro que se jode también. Cuando el DJ pone la música, ella baila como nunca.
Pa' que sepa.
Y ahora a lo puro y sin disimulo, olvidando la pena, la piel. Cuando el DJ pone la música, ella baila como nunca.
Padres general manager AJ Preller was clearly showing a willingness to invest in the immediate success of the Padres, making them currently one of the best teams in the entire league. The Padres are also well known for having one of the best farm systems in the sport, paving the way for loads of young talent, such as Fernando Tatis Jr., to carry the team to success in the future. The 2020 season allowed for fans to see the plans of Padres ownership come into fruition, as the team would put up a staggering 617 win percentage and make the franchise's first playoff run in 14 years. After hitting grand slams in four consecutive games, the team was given the nickname Slam Diego. For the first time in a long time, the Padres were exciting to watch.
Towards the corner, it's back, it's gone! Welcome to Slam Diego! Grand slam for Eric Hosmer!
They lost to the Dodgers in the division series, but the run was enough to inspire many across San Diego that the coming years would be special.
The Padres have affected their community by their commitment to youth baseball and softball. Continued in 2018 with the Future of the Padres initiative, a signature youth baseball and softball programs presented by UC San Diego Health with the support from U.S. Bank. Since 2012, the Padres have donated more than 109,000 jerseys, caps, and headbands to the region's youth players. The San Diego Madres are one instance of the positive impact the Padres have on their community.
Okay, well, the Madres have been together since 1972. So next year will be our 50th anniversary. And they were started by the Padre Wives back in the 70s to help raise funds for Little League Baseball. Last year, I think we donated $21,000 last, $22,000, and we supported like 50 different Little League teams in San Diego County.
The San Diego Padres offer a series of baseball summer camps that enrich the lives of children through exceptional instruction, character development, and a unique Major League experience that creates lasting memories. Then a little voice inside you whispers,